One of the common questions we get asked when it comes to engine development is, what compression ratio should I run? And the compression ratio has a knock-on effect to a number of aspects of the engine operation. To get a little bit more insight into this, we're here with James from Radical Performance Engines to find out exactly what the compression ratio will affect. So James, for a start, we're talking here about your RPE Hayabusa-based V8s in particular. And I want to start by asking what compression ratio you're running in these typically.
Depending on variant, we go from 12.5 to 13.5. We have gone as high as 14.5 running methanol fuels.
Okay, so with the 12.5 to 1 region, what fuel are you able to run with that sort of compression ratio?
We can run a 98 RON minimum.
It's probably a good place to also say that these engines are naturally aspirated, so the numbers here would definitely not work for a turbocharged engine. So on the pump fuels that you're running there, 98 RON, with that sort of compression ratio, maybe 13 to 1, are you knock limited?
Not massively so on these engines. You get to around 32 degrees and you're into the point of diminishing returns. You don't really induce knock at that point. If we really squeeze the compression ratio up to 13.5, you are getting to the point where it does become knock limited.
And for those, I guess, who aren't following that, just to be clear as well, when I'm talking about knock limited, when we're tuning these engines on a dyno, we're advancing the timing and we're watching the engine torque. And as the torque climbs, we know that we're getting our timing optimized, but particularly on a low-grade fuel, we can get to a point where during the combustion process we get the onset of detonation or knock, which is incredibly damaging. So that becomes our limiting factor. We can't add more timing. In fact, we need to pull it back to provide a safety margin. So just want to clear that out of the way there. So with the compression ratios that you've talked about there for pump fuel, 12.5 through to 13.5 to 1, across that range on the RPE V8, what sort of power difference are you seeing?
Around 10 to 15 horsepower.
Okay. So we were starting to talk about the last sort of few percent of engine performance there with that sort of compression ratio change.
Yes.
Do you also see an effect on the engine's fuel efficiency as you change the compression ratio?
Yeah, not massively so. We don't look into it a great deal.
I mean, not maybe for an endurance race it might be important, but not for the sort of racing you're typically seeing?
No.
Now, another term that we talk about when it comes to engine development is squish. Can you just explain for those who maybe haven't heard that term before what exactly squish means?
Yeah, it's the distance between the crown of the piston and the cylinder head. So obviously we would ideally run a tighter squish as possible so we can just force all the air-fuel mixture into a central point in the piston so it can be burned nicely and ensuring a complete combustion.
Okay, so is there a trade-off between squish and your compression ratio?
Well, in an ideal world, you'd get the compression ratio as high as possible and the squish as tight as possible. But if I had a choice between the two to really maximise, I'd always choose squish over compression ratio.
When it comes to increasing the compression ratio, the other thing we're doing here is basically making the crown of the piston taller or filling up more of the combustion chamber when the piston is at or about TDC. So is there a trade-off between increasing the compression ratio and perhaps ending up being detrimental to the flame front travel or combustion process during combustion?
Yeah, if you don't have the sufficient squish to ensure that air fuel mixture is in the correct place to burn, you can end up with a very spontaneous burn, and that also if you're pushing the compression ratio too high, you can end up with a very fast flame front.
I think the other thing, just to come back to your point about squish, we're trying to push all of the fuel air charge into the centre of the combustion chamber there, is when we do get detonation occurring, generally this will start in the end gases around the outside of the combustion chamber. So I guess if we can eliminate those pockets of unburned fuel and air from there, we're reducing the chances of detonation?
Exactly. So if you can squeeze that gap as tight as possible, you're forcing all the air fuel mixture where there would potentially be a detonation event, you're removing that potential.
Look, it's been great to get some insight there, James. Thanks for your time there.
Thank you.
If you liked that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.